which is in realization right now. We have Ivo, who will tell us more where Pipistrel is with realization of this project. And then we will have the very far future, where perhaps some of you heard about the Uber Elevate project. And that's where Nikhil is giving us some more information about it. Let's see, I think you take this microphone, see, yes.
Läuft schon? Ne, nimmt auf, ja?
So, it's yours.
Thanks, Willie. So I'm Nikhil Goyal from Uber. I'm our head of product for Advanced Programs. Advanced Programs is a group headed up by Jeff Holden, our Chief Product Officer. Thanks for having me here today. So, who here has heard of Uber or taken an Uber? Not too many people, okay, half of you. So, Uber is a global ride-sharing company. We started about 5.5 years ago. As you see here, we are worth about $70 billion, operate in 450 more cities worldwide, have over 60 million monthly active passengers. 73 countries, 1.2 billion miles per month traveled on the ground. And recently, we redesigned our entire app, but for those of you who are not familiar, it's basically push a button and get a ride. It's the same concept that we've had for several years. You push a button, you enter your pickup location, your destination. We show you several different options from UberX, which is our more economical product, Uber Select, Uber Black, different classes of automobiles. You push a button, the car comes and picks you up, and you get to your destination. Very simple. Several years ago, when we were continuing with this business model, several of our engineers discovered that a lot of our riders were going from similar pickup locations to similar destinations. And we did an experiment. We said, what if you were able to combine these routes and take multiple passengers, put them in the same car? Basically, you see there, one car would pick up two passengers, drop off the first, drop off the second. So before, when you had two cars, you now have one. And turns out the experiment was an absolute success. Today in San Francisco, over 50% of trips are done via this new ride-sharing method called the Uber Pool. And this is what started kind of what we call the Uber flywheel. We can have fewer cars for more passengers, meaning we free up more cars, meaning the cars are available to other passengers at faster points, meaning we lower the average price per trip, the average price per mile for our passengers. So that's our Uber business today. And about a year ago, we started thinking, what if instead of push a button, get a ride, you could push a button, get a flight? And so in October, we being a very large team, including Mark Moore, who you see in the back, who we just recently hired as our director of engineering, conceived a white paper. This white paper was basically our vision for the future for if you could have on-demand aviation. And we started with a hero journey, San Francisco to San Jose, which is a journey that many people in the Bay Area complete every day. This is a 50-mile or 70-kilometer journey, which in an UberX costs somewhere on the order of $111, and during rush hour in the morning can take up to 2 hours. And looking at vertical takeoff and landing transportation, we imagined, what if you could take this route for only 15 minutes and have it cost only $20. We were extremely confident that if we were to put this option into the Uber app, everybody would take it. And so we set out on a journey to figure out how can we make this possible. And we started looking at vertical takeoff and landing aircraft. And we actually started saying, okay, well, what sort of aircraft would be the best type of aircraft to make this vision a reality? And so we started looking at helicopters and said, very quickly, helicopters are not an option to get to the type of scale that we imagine for vertical takeoff and landing. Why? One, because they're noisy. Two, because the mechanical complexity adds to the cost of operating. And three, we can never get them down to the affordability levels that we needed for on-demand aviation. So instead, we started looking at vehicles such as this. This is the Joby S2. And we started talking to Mark and our technical team and understanding distributed electric propulsion. I think most people in this room are familiar with the concept, but basically in our white paper, we laid out our vision for all electric, distributed electric propulsion aircraft, which through the use of multiple rotors is able to massively reduce the sound profile of these vehicles, particularly during takeoff and landing, so you can operate within cities at massive scale. These are just some of the types of vehicles we're looking at, everything from multi-copters here on the left to more distributed electric propulsion designs on the right, with the addition of a fixed wing, which gives us an additional efficiency boost, allowing for longer ranges on our platform. And we also, in our white paper, imagine vertiports that look like this. These are vertiports that you can imagine deep within a city's core, simply remodeled tops of parking garages, tops of buildings. And what's interesting about these is you can put these absolutely anywhere in a city. You can imagine 2 to 4 to 6 takeoff and landing positions, 10 to 12 charging positions where aircraft can park during the day, all electric chargers, drop-off areas and pick-up areas for Ubers, pedestrians. You can imagine this paired with public transit. We imagine that over time, as self-driving vehicles take over a city, as you start to have electric aviation within a city, you can start to convert some of these parking garages into what we're calling vertiports and vertistops, and we're very excited about this vision. We've also done a large amount of analysis, which we'll be presenting at our upcoming Uber Elevate Summit. Our summit's at on April 25th, April 26th in Dallas, Texas. Mark Moore, you can see him after the presentation for more information about our summit and what we'll be presenting, but we've done some super interesting analysis around cities all over the world. And what's really interesting about Uber entering the space is Uber likes to focus on efficiency. We like to focus on understanding how people move in and around the city, and we've done a large amount of analysis to understand where passengers are being picked up and dropped off today. Why is that interesting? Because, well, we can start to look at this and understand where should vertistops be in a city, where should vertiports be in a city, and using that we can work with government, with city officials, with vehicle developers to understand what the ideal mission for on-demand urban aviation looks like. And then finally, we imagine all of this transportation to be multimodal. So here's a mock-up of what that may look like. With Uber, just like today, you push a button, get a ride, you go from point A to point B, we imagine that would stay the same. And so you'd push a button, enter your destination, we would tell you how to get to the nearest vertiport, whether that's through walking, whether that's through taking a self-driving Uber. You would arrive at your origin vertiport, take a flight to your destination vertiport, and then go to your final destination, all in one button. And that's the power that Uber can provide. So, here's the Uber Elevate Summit website. Would love for all of you to take a look. Would love to see all of you in Dallas. And then Mark's going to join me on stage for questions later.
So thank you. And now I think you have seen why Uber is reacting so fast. If you saw you speaking here so quick and giving us this summit, and you also see why we are so happy to have you here, because we have conventional aircraft here. It's a 25th aero, and this is the future. We don't know how quick it will come, so this perhaps would be just one quick question to you. I know you have to leave to the airport, and then Mark could answer more questions after we listen to the visions of all the other people here on stage. So when do you think this will be possible?
I certainly hope that we'll see this within a decade. In fact, I'll be disappointed if we don't see Uber flying vehicles within a decade. So we're very excited about this, and that's what Uber does. That's how we roll. We like to move very, very quickly, and we look forward to partnering with manufacturers across the ecosystem, with those who provide airspace solutions, with those who provide battery solutions, with those who provide rapid rechargers. And we'll be announcing a lot of these partnerships at the summit, partnerships not only with technology, but with governments, with regulators, with policymakers all across the world. And we've been forming partnerships in very rapid paces, and we'll be announcing them at the summit. So we're very excited to be extremely collaborative in this space.
So thank you, Nikhil, and thank you for the visit here. We hope to see you on a regular basis now at Aero. And now this, as you have seen, is a vision of how the future could look. As the next, we have Ivo, who we have had here for all the EDFlight Expos, as he's the expert in electric aviation right now. And he is being the visionary, because he came out with the first electric aircraft with a Taurus Electro some years ago. And so Ivo, you, we have on the screen in the back your we'll come back up again, the hybrid Pantera, the Hipster project, which was there here at the show last year. So please let us know, what is the future like? You see it from where you are now.
Thank you for the word. Yes, in Pipistrel we believe in electric flight last 20 years. And believe me, it's nice to be a pioneer, but it's very hard to live from this. In 2007, we introduced first serially produced two-seater aircraft, but nowadays you can count on the fingers of one hand in how many countries we are flying legally. But thanks to the regulators, I must say, today was also published in Europe, EASA published the amendment from CS 23 revision 5, what make reality for also non-conventional technologies, propulsions, and this will put a big push also to electric and hybrid propulsions. You know, flying electric today, nowadays everybody is talking about. But as our Tine Tomasic, director of our R&D Institute, said, there were still more people in the space that they were flying electric aircraft. Or there were more people on the moon than flying VTOL electric aircraft. So this is a real new type of flying, and what we are afraid of is how the customers, how the pilots, how the community will perceive, how they will accept this new way of flying. And that's very important. We are working on the technical side, of course, and we are ready also for projects like Uber is mentioning. But we must be very careful because, you know, if there is a car accident, everybody is first asking if the driver was drunk. But if there is an aircraft accident, everybody is asking if the engine quit. So the technology must be really safe before we go on public, and we must convince, we must work on marketing, on public relations in a way that we will convince our future customers, which will have nothing to do with piloting, that electric flight is safe, you know. And this, what we are talking about today, about vertical takeoff, you know, in the beginning it was short takeoff, now it's vertical takeoff. In future, will this vertical takeoff, I believe it's only a medium stage to the final solution, which will be, I have a here written, W takeoff and landing. Why? Because we will bring the person somewhere in the neighborhood in 15 floor, and we will bring the person in somewhere in the center in 25th floor. This will be a final goal of electric propulsion and electric flight. And the new rules will, I'm very positive that the regulators now will follow the progress, and that's first time after the Second World War that we are followed by the regulators. Before we were always in front of regulators. Now the regulators understand that this is the only way to go forward together, and this will now make a new era of flight. And if you go in the airports, don't forget to check the aircraft, because these aircraft still have wings. Tomorrow will be the aircraft without the wings, and also waste of place for the airports will not be needed anymore. That's the future.
Okay, thank you, Ivo. And we saw in your speech that you're very passionate on what you're doing. And it's very nice, because for the first time I hear you speaking positively on the regulators, which is also some new thing here for the show.
That's reality, you know.
This is very good. And perhaps as we now heard you speaking on the regulators, we have Stefan Ronning here from EASA. I just checked to get the right presentation. That's on? Perfect. Thank you. And manipulator. Right.
Okay, thanks for the invitation and the occasion to be here and present something here. Of course, I will not tell you how these new aircraft will look like in 20 years. We have to be prepared, or we have to try as a regulator the framework. As I'm the regulator, I start with the problems we have. We have not yet any really tailored certification, specification covering these new or all these new possible designs of aircraft. Our rules and regulations do not yet really address all emerging technologies, and especially the operation. And we thanks for the kind words on CS23, but of course that's only part of the story. We have the airworthiness specifications, but these operation is also, or these aircraft and the possible operation is a challenge for all other aspects of operation, flight crew licensing, operations, aerodromes, ATM. So we have a lot of work to do. Most of these new designs we see, or we have already seen here, are crossover designs between traditional aircraft categories, and we need to try to be active as possible and think out of the box. And of course, we also have to deal with new stakeholders. And if you talk about the unmanned aircraft area or these optional piloted mobility on demand, we as a European agency, we have suddenly a complete new stakeholder groups. To visualize the complexity, this is a mind map we had developed on electric propulsion. I think it was also on the screen last year here. And I don't want to explain it, we can spend the next hour, but it should simply visualize the complexity. Now, we have a lot of regulations affected, we have a lot of certification inspectors, standards, industry standards. The process is important for how to certify. The technologies are really impressive and diverse. They come from all other activities, space, automotive, consumer electronics. So we are really challenged, and we have new stakeholder groups. And probably for us, the most important, of course, as a regulator, are the regulations affected. And there we have made a lot of progress on initial airworthiness. We try to improve the progress, and we have set up a system to progress in these aspects. We have set up, or we have quite some activities within the agency, within EASA. We have a project on unmanned aircraft, and on the first look, it does not look really related to the topic of carrying persons around in cities, but a lot of the technologies is coming from unmanned aircraft or is similar, and there's a lot of activity that we can use. We have also established a small group internally working on electric hybrid propulsion. We have a strong cooperation with rotorcraft, as we sometimes it's not really identifiable if an aircraft is a rotorcraft or an aeroplane or whatever. And very important, in Europe we have the development of low-level traffic management for unmanned aircraft. It's called U-Space. It started last November with the Warsaw Declaration. And this will also affect the transport of persons, especially in urban areas. On the airworthiness side, we have certification specifications, special conditions, and means of compliance. So we have already reviewed the ops rules, the basic regulation for necessary changes on electric propulsion. We had in the past a lot of regulations, something about fuel lines, about fuel quantities, and this is not really helpful when you want to certify something without fuel. We have developed a lot of special condition, and we are going on. We have quite a lot of flexibility here, and sometimes it's not a disadvantage to have not a CS, because a CS might drive you in a certain direction to design an aircraft in a certain way. So we have some flexibility, especially in the European area, to develop special conditions, and we use this flexibility. And the new CS23 is a very good example how we can move on without, probably in the future, without the need to go through this development process, because we have just published a CS23 that it's not really design specific, that has reduced the number of, on the level of detail of requirements significantly, dramatically, and it mainly contains the safety objectives. On a lower level, we have airworthiness design standards developed by the industry, mainly by the industry, and they contain the details, and they are able, we are able to follow the technical development. So we will not be any more the body that is hindering the development. It's industry that can develop the standards as fast as needed, and we have the step to endorse the standards, to accept them as means of compliance. The certification aspect is one element, but of course also the certification process seems to be complicated, or too complicated, for a lot of stakeholders, and we are also active in this area. We have a rulemaking task, part 21, proportionality. We want to introduce flexibility and simplification in part 21. Part 21 is the European regulation, or the annex to the European regulation, with the certification process, all the elements you have to follow, and the process you have to follow when you want to certify an aircraft, certify an engine, certify equipment. The target of this rulemaking group are mainly small organizations designing and manufacturing simple products. And we have a stepped approach here. We want to first publish alternative AMC material for design organization and production organization. We want to test these material in a few test cases, and in the next step, develop a new approach, probably a complete new Part 21 light that would be or would follow the changes to the basic regulation. At the moment, the basic regulation of EASA is under review. It's in the political process, and it will contain, for example, declarative elements for simple aircraft, and this would be a big change in the attitude, or in give new options, and this should be introduced then also in part 21. Especially on this, I can invite you on a workshop we have on Friday, 11 o'clock. It's in this area, the room Rome, and this is a workshop to get the first feedback on material we just published there, that should simplify the entry into the EASA system, and this is probably also, or quite sure, important for a lot of new stakeholders that develop or come from the experimental side, and they want to enter into the EASA system. And so we give new options there. And that's from my side.
Okay, thank you very much, and sorry that I try to rush you through the program, but what I want to do is really giving a vision, and for the vision, we have to get different point of views, because otherwise we always have only one little point. So we have had the vision of United States, or the worldwide vision of Uber. We have had Evo's vision of a manufacturer. We have had EASA. So right now I would like to introduce Mr. Zhou from, he is from the project which you all have seen 2 years ago here, which is the RX1E presentation, which is, you see it here on the screen, you have seen the aircraft here, and it is flying since 3 years, so it's the first LSA certified aircraft, electric aircraft. It was done in China from CAAC. And now it's Mr. Zhou to give us a quick update where you are with the project now, and if you can see it again, perhaps next year on the show flying here.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for the chance to present for RGE some information of RGE here. So RGE's name is an abbreviation of Liaoning Aviation, General Aviation Academy. Of one academy of China. So our academy is has a vision. So we aimed to a full linkage growing, such as forecast market forecasting and project trade-off and design test, flight test, and certification and customer supporting and so forth. So our main product is RX1E series electronic aircraft. So here's our first electric aircraft. Here is the name is RX1E. So we used almost 5 years to get the first TDE of RSE in China from CAAC, and 2 years for PC. So we are the electronic aircraft milestone in China RSE market. So we are proud of that, but we are trying to do all and fully the linkage growing. So now we are trying to developing some a new type, such as extend the range and endurance and four-seat hybrid or electronic aircraft. So that's all our information of LGAA. And I'm very happy here. So many manufacturer here. So we welcome all of you, all of the friends to go to China, to go to RGE, to visit RGE. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this presentation. And I think one thing which I wanted to show here on the screen is this is really a global movement. This is not some development which is in San Francisco or only in Europe. It is really a movement, a changing of our aviation worldwide. And that's why I'm very thankful that you're coming here. Actually, we're going to try to have an event at the end of the year in China. We will all keep you updated there, and then we can see with our own eyes what is happening in China. We have seen here, which is a conventional aircraft with electric propulsion, which we have several here in the Hall A7. Now we're going to go again to the other way of flying, which is a future way of flying. We'll have Stefan Reuter from Evolo presenting us their vision of vertical takeoff electric, which is existing right now, which is already flying with preliminary certification in Germany. And with this, we Germans are kind of leading country, because in many countries there are no possibilities to fly there. I just want to make one little point, as we have the EASA here on the stage, because there is at the moment some ongoing demand for raising the weight limit for ultralight aircraft up to 600 kilograms. This aircraft is flying here because we have the ultralight class. Because of this, it was possible to fly very quickly. And perhaps we may discuss this a bit later. So it's up to you, Stefan, on the technical side, and we'll hear perhaps something more on the 600 kilogram side later. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinny. Thanks for having us. My name is Florian. I'm from Evolo in Karlsruhe, Germany, and we are the makers of the Volocopter. Just a quick check, quick show of hands. Who of you has heard or seen of the Volocopter in the past? Okay, great. That makes my job a bit easier. You know, I grow to like this test even better, Mark. You know what I'm talking about. Great. So, quick introduction on the technology features of the Volocopter. It's an absolutely innovative, novel type of aircraft. It is vertical takeoff and landing, capable of carrying two persons, completely distributed electric propulsion. So we are using lithium-ion battery technology to get us up in the air. And as Willy already pointed out, we set out in developing an ultralight vehicle, so we limited it to two persons and tried to stay below the weight limit of 450 kilo, that is that we're operating under in order to get started inside the ultralight certification scheme that we have here in Europe and Germany in particular. The main features of the Volocopter are it's handled extremely simple. There's just a single joystick that you can touch, put your hand on, and operate the vehicle absolutely intuitively. So hardly any piloting skills required. A five-year-old kid could instantly operate the Volocopter, and it could do so in a very safe way. So the flight control of the Volocopter will take away much of the flying skills that usually required, any disturbances from wind, any landing operations and so on, are assisted in a way that it's extremely simple and extremely safe to operate. At the same time, compared to a conventional helicopter, we try to stay away from most of the mechanical complexity that you would find there. Rather, we put the complexity into the electronic systems, which at the same time gives us a lot of redundancy abilities and it takes away a lot of the safety critical issues and also of maintenance issues. I'll get back to that in a second. The third main element of it, it's what we consider green, and that not only means it can be flown emission-free as long as it's operated fully electric. Of course, we're also working on integrating a hybrid solution simply due to the range limitations that we currently have with existing battery technology. And but apart from the emission-free, we also point towards its acoustic signature. So this vehicle is far lower noise, has far lower noise emissions than conventional helicopters, and we even go so far as to say our preliminary conclusions lead us to the statement that this vehicle is quiet enough to be operated inside our cities today. You can blend in these operations of these vehicles into existing city traffic and you will hardly have any increase in disturbance observed from people and the citizens of that city. And I think this is an extremely important element to be incorporated when trying to convince city makers, rule makers, and so on to incorporate such solutions worldwide. Last aspect I think that's important to mention, based on the first three, it all leads also to extremely low operational costs. So I talked about the being driven all electric, so the energy cost is low, the low mechanical complexity, so maintenance and overhaul efforts are low. Overall, this vehicle can be operated at very, very attractive cost positions, and that's why we think it will be cost competitive to other transportation solutions very soon. That's where we're getting at. So in combination of these features, we see the great future of the Volocopter as a means of transportation inside the cities of our world. This is an example of San Francisco, simply because a lot of the discussion on these evolving business models and operational models is happening over in San Francisco, partly due to your work, Mark, over there. Clearly, we absolutely embrace the vision of these kinds of vehicles to be operating inside our cities and being a conventional, common mode of transportation for all of us. And this is where we are gearing the Volocopter towards, and this is what we're working for. And therefore, we of course also embrace efforts like Uber. Really.
Thank you very much, Florian. And we are looking at your aircraft. And I remember when the very first one was at our booth with a gummy ball for at the pilot seat for protecting him.
It has evolved.
And it has definitely evolved in a very short time to a real product, and you find the visionaries, as I heard, also on the investor side, who are going in there, and I think with having companies like Uber on there, it will even get more people on board for having this visionary kind of flying. We heard about several airframe manufacturers now, so I would like to, if you could pass the microphone to Frank Anton, because all these aircraft need electric motors, and I know that's where you're working.
I guess we have no slides. I only have words and motors.
No, there is the slide of last year as we had the presentation of the X-ray here, which was the star of our very first, world's first e-flight show. So I thought that's a good base for hearing what are your up-to-date work and what are the visions. It does Siemens think you will, or the Siemens is also working on vertical takeoff projects already? Just give us an overview, please.
Okay, so Siemens is working from the top down and from the bottom up. What does that mean? On the one hand, we work together with Airbus in a huge project where both companies are investing a lot, really a lot, into developing hybrid electric propulsion systems for aircraft in three different power ranges, starting from 100 kilowatt, which is more the two-seater, four-seater type of aircraft, up to 10 megawatt. 10 megawatt. Now, 10 megawatt is more or less the power that you need for cruise flight of an A320. And all of these hybrid electric propulsion systems, Airbus and Siemens collaboration is going to test until 2020 on ground. Yeah, so that is coming from the top. Coming from the bottom is as important. Distributing electrically propelled aircraft in this world and getting pilots have the stick of an electric aircraft in their hand. And why is that important? I need not tell you, because you are probably, most of you are pilots sitting here at this show. You all know, we decide about what we have felt, what we have sensed, what we have experienced in flight. And if there is no experience about flying electrically, the decision maker of a big company going for a project is probably not going to decide electric, but if he has or she has flown an electric aircraft herself, then the decision may be positive. And this is why we have to come from the bottom. And this is why it is so important that these small aircraft are flying and we make flight experience with the eFusion, which is a LSA two-seater and which has now more than 40 flight hours. And with the Extra, which is 260 kilowatts, 350 horsepower aerobatic aircraft. And both of them were flying yesterday, the first electric flight show in the world, here at this show for the press, and doing aerobatics also, the Extra. And there are two aspects to it. One is, I have to say, EASA is very helpful. EASA is very positively setting up the mind and creating the rules together with industry. And the second thing is, flying these electric aircrafts is so unspectacular. I mean, who has ever tried to re-engage a hot piston engine after having flown and switched it off and now you want to fly again on a hot day? Or get it running on a cold day, yeah, this is challenging. Yeah, on an electric aircraft, you just make like this and fly. It's now, from top, the large ones. Hybrid, we always say hybrid, because we need the kerosene or the fuel as the energy carrier. There is no way of doing very long flights just with batteries. When it comes to the advantages of electric propulsion, then I have to mention distributed propulsion. And Mark Moore, who is sitting to my right, is the man behind the X-57 Maxwell, which is the demonstrator for values of the distributed propulsion, blowing the wings, yawing, and all these things. But there could also be on a intercontinental flight, you could gain something from boundary layer ingestion by very small distributed electric motors sitting all on the wings and just sucking the boundary layer at the right point. Could that be things? Well then, again coming back to the lower, to the smaller aircraft, the future will definitely, definitely use vector thrust. And if you look at our Extra, which has just recently done the very first glider towering with an electric aircraft in the world, then this was born as vector thrust, because if you look at the video, it didn't go like that, like a normal glider towing, but what the Extra did was actually vector thrust, like this. And then it went up in 72 seconds up to 600 meters. And now imagine, you have this motor
being able to be moved, and these eight of them or more, and you have the vertical takeoff. This will definitely come with electric propulsion. And now I know that you are thinking about something which is short range and which only has batteries. But then I would say, again, I do need, as a manufacturer, I will need to be able to offer a hybrid generator for that, because once people have this, they will immediately ask, oh, could I also use this vertical takeoff and then not fly just to the next skyscraper, but continue my flight for 5 hours? And if you just put in less battery and more generator and a bit of fuel, you can do this, certainly. So, does this cover all the future that we can do with electric? Not yet even, because what we have just heard from Nikhil, I mean, when we were here, like Willy, a couple of years ago, for the first time in this panel, you were all looking at me like I was crazy when I was talking about electric propulsion. Now you all see that it is becoming real. Today, Nikhil told us something which sounds crazy. And I'm sure it will be real very soon. And what does this bring in addition? You have the app in mind, which creates the relation between the traveler who wants to get from A to B and the different things that get him there. But what immediately comes with it is scale. Industrial scale. All I have said up to now was talking about aircraft where the OEM makes 100 a year. And if it is 1,000, it is already a huge business for the OEM. And now, what Uber is going to talk about could generate a market into which tens of thousands of these aircraft could be sold. And this would completely change this industry. Because then, all of a sudden, this hand-making single piece of aircraft industry would become a industrial-scale industry. Wow.
Okay, thank you, Frank, for this vision. And we see that also Siemens shares the vision of that aviation will be modified very fast and very strong with this. For as last presentation, because I know probably you, like me, have a lot of questions on our presenters here. But wait until we have our last presentation, then we still have some time for questions. So Holger Kuhn from Bauhaus Luftfahrt, a think tank in Germany, which is developing ideas of the future of tomorrow, will tell us what you have developed up to now, envisioned.
Okay, so you have heard a lot of problems and issues and demonstrators and what can be done today, and visions and markets and whatever. So we at Bauhaus, we have luckily the situation that we live and think in the future, and we don't have to care about the problems today. So, but there's a main motivation for us, because there's something real today. I will skip some slides. So these are some efficiency goals for future aircraft. And from the ACARE working group, that's a group related to the European Commission. And what you see highlighted in red boxes are some emission goals for 2050. So 2050 is really far away. And this strategic research and innovation agenda addresses more than just only these emission targets. And I will just highlight some ideas, some possibilities, some, well, concepts that may satisfy all these goals fixed by the ACARE working group. And so that's a chart showing you the propulsive efficiency and the of propulsion systems. And you see that today we are here at the reference technology, so that's the level 2000 technology, because that's the level this research agenda relates to. And highlighted are the goals of 2020, 2035, and 2050. And you see if you realize some really novel concepts of conventional propulsion that you may satisfy the goals in 2020 and maybe 2035. But beyond that, there's nothing you can realize with today's technologies. And many studies, not only by us, but also by NASA and other research institutes in the world, it's going electric beyond that. So if we really try to fix the goal in 2050, we have to go electric in some way, either fully electric or hybrid electric. So I think that's, with respect to that, what Frank Anton said, that for the large power class, you need hybrid electric to do even a high range. So that's our motivation. I will skip this. I will show you one concept we developed in 2011, 2012, and showed it first at the ILA in Berlin. So that's our sea liner. Maybe someone of you have heard of that or read about that. It's a fully electric transport aircraft, so we think big, so we don't think about 2 to 4 persons or 10 persons. We try to address a commercial transport aircraft class. So this aircraft, you see some aerodynamic advanced technologies. It's fully electric. It's it has space for 190 passengers, because a market analysis showed that in 2035-2050, when this entry into service of this aircraft is envisaged, the aircraft class of 190 passengers and 900 nautical miles range is the class to address. So that's the design point of this aircraft. So 190 passengers, 900 nautical miles, fully electric. We made some, we incorporated some really novel and enhanced technologies into this aircraft, like this the C-wing. You see there's no elevator in the back. So we just have this two superconducting electric machines, electric fans, and fully electric subsystems, so everything is powered by the batteries we have on board. And you can trade the batteries and the passengers to get the fully load of 190 passengers, or reduce and get a higher range. That's one concept. And I'm happy that the specific energy of the battery is not on the slide. So another concept addressing long-range aircraft, the wide bodies, is this aft fuselage fan. So we investigated two concepts. The first one, you see there's a gas turbine-driven fan in the back of the fuselage, ingesting the boundary layer to enhance the propulsive efficiency. And by this, we may realize a block fuel emission by 9%. So transport aircraft are grasping for every efficiency point you can get. So 9% is okay. The next concept, basically the same design, but in the back, you don't have a gas turbine driving the fan, you have an electric machine driving an aft fan, and getting the electricity by two generators of conventional geared turbofans, gas turbines. Realizing this concept may realize a block fuel consumption of 11%. That's great, but we are far away from this 75% in 2050, so that's maybe an intermediate step. And the last point I would like to highlight is in this research agenda, there was one point that 90% of all flights within Europe, there should be no traveling time of more than 4 hours from door to door. And that's quite challenging. Even if you just think of a flight from Hamburg to Munich, you can't realize that. So another concept we have thought of is reducing this, or realizing this 4 hours door to door. And that's quite controversial, this concept, but that's possibly only one solution. Today, the large airports are located far outside of the city centers, and sometimes you have just 1 or 2 hours to get to the airport. So 2 hours of this four hours door to door is just lost. And our idea was now to reduce this traveling time to the airport, to put the airport into the city again. So now, how to do this? There are some spaces in the city you may use for this, and these are these larger train stations. You find in every big city a lot of train stations. And our thought is, okay, let's use this space. But how to use this space? It's obviously, if the train comes in, you are as quick as possible at the airport, because when the train stops, you are at the airport. Our concept is this is a building with 4 levels. So at the bottom level, the trains are arriving, and you get to the next level, maybe for merchandising or whatever, city centers and conference centers, whatever you can realize there. On the 3rd level, there's the security check. And to reduce this security check, you do the security check by walking to the airport. So there's no queue you have to wait, there's no desk you have to wait. You do this on the walk to the aircraft. And then finally, you enter the aircraft on the first sub-level. The aircraft gets its carriage, it gets boarded and so on. And then by an elevator, the aircraft is put to the surface. And there you have the runway, and you see the dimensions of this building. It's just roughly 650 meters long and 90 meters wide, because that's the typical dimensions of a train station we may utilize. And of course, that's an airport, not a usual aircraft can land and depart on. So we designed and developed an own aircraft, especially only for this airport. It's an aircraft designed for city travelers, so from one city to the next city, having not huge amounts of baggage, but just a little case with them. And unfortunately, it's propelled by conventional gas turbines, but you see the location is in the aft again, and the design of the tail fin and so on is to reduce the noise pattern of this aircraft. So calculations show that this aircraft, similarly to a volocopter, you won't hear in the city. So yes, I will stop here. These are some concepts, some point solutions to the goals set in the future, and well, we try to address these.
Thank you, Holger. And when we start the question and answer session now, we still have some 15 minutes time. So first I would ask Igor to the stage, because Ivo had to leave. Igor is working at Pipistrel since a long time. He was responsible also in the Hipster project. And he can, because the first question would be to Pipistrel from my side, because we heard that Ivo said that he has even something better than VTOL, which is double VTOL, WTOL. Are you working on such a concept already?
We have a concept which are working on, but we cannot talk of it today, so.
Okay, so so what would be the next step concept you can talk about, because there are some visions I know in electric flying which you have?
Well, actually our approach is to develop building blocks, because as you know, there is this opportunity of having a new way to move, especially this mobility, urban mobility. we see this convergence for the first time toward a mass industry, which is something that aviation has not seen since the 50s. But still, the technology blocks and the regulations are not in place. That's why for us at the moment, it makes sense to develop propulsion blocks, software to do the calculation validation through models, and also work with authorities to find out some test and some case data, especially to validate the safety of this system. Because public acceptance and safety will be at stake for this electrical VTOL industry.
Okay, thank you. The next question would be to Frank Anton, as today in the general press conference, I heard you saying to ask the journalists, please support the 600 kilograms for ultralight aircraft in Europe. Can you give us a short explanation why you think this is important? Why do you think we need this for the quick future of electric plane?
We have a fully battery-based electric aircraft flying. That is the E-Fusion. It has an empty weight, including the batteries, of 410 kilograms. And as an experimental, it has a maximum takeoff weight of 600, which allows for 190 kilograms of two pilots, passengers, and luggage. And this is very reasonable. Today, this aircraft flies for half an hour. With better battery technologies, we will extend this to 1 hour and even further. And this makes sense. Anything smaller does not make sense as an electric aircraft. So when we get the 600, we will see many different types of ultralight electric battery-based aircraft that generate a lot of fun for an hour and have half an hour of reserve. If the limit is 560, if the limit is 540, this disappears. And it is not much fun flying for 15 minutes and half an hour of reserve.
Okay, thank you. Stefan, could I get a quick comment from EASA on this? Although I know it's not your core working place, but what does EASA think of it and where do you think it's going? Just your personal judgment, what I would like to.
Okay, we do not believe in mass thresholds as a reasonable distinction between aircraft. So whatever weight threshold we have, 450, 600, 750, 1200, 2000, 5.7 tons, it always creates issues and it can create, it should not lead to a significant gap and difference in the regulatory system if it something is 10 kilo plus or minus. And of course we also believe in European standardized harmonized rules as far as possible. So the approach we have is to simplify the rules on European level. We would feel it quite strange if we would have a 20 kilo unmanned aircraft that is an EASA aircraft and a 600 kilo quite complex aircraft that is not an EASA aircraft.
Okay, now I open the session also for questions from the audience. So if anybody of you has a question, just lift the hand, we will bring you a microphone. You can think about it if you have a question, as long as I will keep asking questions which interests myself, which very often interests also the other people. So Mark, as you worked for NASA for a long time, now you work for Uber. First, I have two questions. First question would be, what is the major difference between these two approaches? Because you still work on the same thing, you work on electric aircraft. And the second thing is, when do you think that an aircraft like the vertical takeoff, the range you want, would be available? First, we asked Nikki before when the system could work. I think now from the technical point of view, when do you think we can have such an aircraft?
Okay, two great questions. First of all, NASA is about creating great new technologies. Uber is about creating great new user experiences. So Uber is completely focused on making this real, turning these into products. Uber is not developing their own vehicles. They're working with great vehicle developer companies, to bring those to you. Now, Nikhil said within a decade. I'm going to be much more precise than that, and that is, these vehicles are already flying. You're not seeing all of them, we are, and many of them are utterly spectacular, and it's becoming very real. And within the next 3 years, we will be conducting tests in urban environments with our vehicle partners to show just how quiet they are, just how safe they are, and just how real they are. Within 6 years, we expect to start operations, to start flying people around in these aircraft as vertical takeoff ride-sharing services. And within a decade, to have hundreds of aircraft. Again, what Frank said is so meaningful, because this is a really exciting time. General Aviation has the opportunity here to grow up and become a commercial product. Instead of recreational or hobby or high-end luxury products, there is the opportunity to hit scaled markets with these new vehicles and impact people daily in their transportation experience. So we're really excited to work with companies such as Siemens to do what hasn't been done since World War II, and that is achieve incredible scale production volumes for your transportation solutions in the skies.
Okay, thank you. And I have another question. As you mentioned, safety. And we all know when you have vertical takeoff and you fly somewhere from the city, this question would be to Florian and to you yourself, perhaps, because you probably have all. What are the additional safety systems? Is there a thinking of, I know there is a ballistic parachute on the volocopter right now. Are there systems, are there companies working on advanced systems like this? Because the ballistic systems we have right now, they are basically the same that we have in the last 25 years. We're like BRS, a company from the United States developing, like they are on the Cirrus. Are there new concepts on the way? Because I think this is very interesting for us pilots at all, because if there is a new safer system, it would make all the aircraft safer, potentially.
So, thank you for the question. The volocopter per se, we believe, is the safest sports aircraft that has ever been built. So our intention is to never have to use the parachute. At the same time, because it's so innovative, you know, people feel very comfortable in having the parachute, and we therefore continue to build it in. Coming to your question, really, yes, there is great innovation also happening in the parachute environment. So whereas historically you needed to have a certain height and a certain speed to really ensure that the parachute comes to full effect, There's companies working towards lowering the required speed and height tremendously. So I think we will have access to such systems that, you know, can already save your life at a height of 10 meters very soon. And of course, once this technology becomes available, we are the first ones to integrate it because we think safety comes first. And you know, as long as we can increase safety, that's always a good thing on our end.
Mark, I don't know if you want to add to that.
I mean, distributed electric propulsion is a fundamentally new opportunity for the design of aircraft to achieve true propulsion redundancy. And that is, again, I think Frank said, or someone said, hey, you know, when an aircraft crashes, the first thing that they ask is, you know, did the engine quit? That's not relevant, because we won't have one engine. We won't just have two engines. We will have true thrust and propulsion redundancy, which gives us all sorts of new degrees of freedom to achieve much higher levels of safety. And these will be controlled as a digital fly-by-wire system where we can take advantage of the ability of advanced computation devices that are very compact and in many ways much better at doing mundane tasks than a pilot even. And so we're in this exciting period over the next 20 years where we'll be blending different technologies as this wonderful convergence happens to achieve autonomous vehicles that are safer than even driving cars. So we live in a very exciting time where there's all sorts of technologies that are coming together into new types of integrated products that will be extremely safe.
Okay, thank you, Mark. And we have one question from the audience.
With all the pilots here, of course, you led right into my next question. What does the podium think of autonomous flying vehicles, self-flying?
So I think perhaps it would be a nice question to the EASA, because without the authority saying yes or no to it, we will not have them in our skies.
Okay, autonomy seems to be a very controversial term or in that concept. When we came up with our concept of operation for unmanned aircraft, and we have not excluded transport of passengers with aircraft without a pilot on board and a high level of autonomy, we were called crazy. You don't have to do it, it's outside of the scope of ICAO, so why do you try to solve these problems? They are not there yet, but we see them now very clearly. And we have a definition of unmanned aircraft. It's there's no pilot on board of the aircraft, but it does not mean that there is no person on board on the aircraft, and that does also not exclude that there's not even a pilot on the ground. So we are ready for that conceptually, but we don't have yet the regulations. So we have to work on that. We have to find ways to deal with it. We have to also integrate them in the airspace, and there will be the need for decision making, and it's not yet accepted that machines take over decisions that the pilot is doing today. So for a lot of operation today, we will need the pilot on the ground to take the decisions, and we need the technology, the command and control thing that's reliable enough.
Okay, thank you. So we have the next question.
Yes, thank you. We have seen many requests from different continents, basically, on electrical flight. So the question is going to EASA again. Is there a general timeline where EASA is thinking they will bring a certain basic regulation where all the industries and products needs to follow?
I don't think that the concept is that the industry has to follow the regulations and the EASA. We try to develop a framework within the industry can develop, and the standards will drive the technology. So the industry will drive the standards, and we have to make a decision if we can accept them. We have started a long time ago, nearly 10 years ago, to certify the first electric engine, to certify the first electric powered aircraft. It was a niche market at that time. It seems now to be ready to be a mass market, but to be able to have a detailed prescriptive requirement for vertical takeoff, this should not happen. It should be flexible and let the industry develop.
Okay, we have one last question because we have to close at 3 o'clock, so we have this question. Be sure gonna keep on writing and keeping you update on what's happening here. We sure there are some more electric presentations here on the stage during the Aero Show, so please have a look at the calendar where you see what else is going on. There is also one thing which I have to say, because this is actually what I'm mainly doing. We have made a summary of all the electric aircraft and what's happening here at the show. In this summary, please feel free to grab one. And we even have a Chinese and an English version of it, which you can download, and you can get the information in our booth in A7. And now to the last question, please.
Okay. Well, as a private pilot, I'm well aware of the realities of weather and how that impacts how this transport method works. And I'm wondering how that has been considered from a technical point of view, you know, like the pocket airports and vertical takeoff, and maybe for Mark or for anybody that has some experience in working this area. How do we address that to make this work?
Mark?
Yeah, one of the exciting things about working with electric aircraft, so a downside and a plus, is that they're extremely range limited, right? They're an energy constrained system. So that means we can't fly very far. So, and for urban needs, frankly, we don't need to fly very far. We're seeing average trips on the order of 20 to 30 miles distance. Well, when you're only traveling 20 or 30 miles, and you're doing that at 150 miles per hour, your flight time is less than 10 minutes. So there's a the degree of uncertainty. I mean, that's the problem with weather, right? Is if you're flying for several hours, the weather changes in several hours. If you're only flying for 5 to 10 minutes, the uncertainty is significantly decreased. And as we populate urban environments with hundreds of these ride-sharing services, we will have telemetry on every one of these aircraft, sharing the weather data. So all of a sudden, we come up with, we think, believe, very detailed, much more accurate weather predictions that are locality-based. So micro weather prediction models that help us to be much more accurate. Still, if you look at many cities and many environments, such as New York, already there's these type of operations with helicopters. Blade is a company that's already doing what we're proposing, but with helicopters today, with many noise complaints. If you look at their how weather impacts their operations, mostly it's visibility concerns, low ceilings. 90% of the time, it's low ceilings, which is the problem. There's actually very exciting technology solutions as we bring in very precise digital mapping and awareness to the pilot where we can solve that problem. The other 10% is either winds or icing. There's also some things we can do in that regard. So I would say weather is a real, it is our big concern. That's our uncertainty up in the air, right? Autonomous flying cars up in the air, better deal with weather. Autonomous cars on the road, they have, you know, ground clutter. We don't have that kind of clutter. Just weather is the problem. So it's a great question, but we have some great solutions that are making it much less of a problem.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Frank, also, yes.
One addition from my side. Siemens is working in many fields. We have electric drivetrains in locomotives, in coal mines, you have it. So we know what all has to be done, and it's quite a lot that you have to do. We have to, very simply, we have to cope with lightning, cold, hot, water, and everything. We have to cope with that. So the motors have to develop from where they are today to something that you can expose to all these weather situations and everything. And by the way, for the 10 megawatt, we are working on a superconducting generator, and that will mean for the first time ever that even at flight level 350, inside the machine, it will be colder than outside.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we have only time at the 3 o'clock. We have to close here. Perhaps who's more interested in the Uber Vision, Mark has a presentation tomorrow morning at 9:30 here on the stage. We have another podium discussion on electric and on Friday, where Frank is also on the stage on the implementation in gliders. And right after this, we have on Friday the eFlight Expo Award, where we donate the prize for some achievement in electric flying, which have happened several times since the beginning, actually 9 times, because we are at the 9th eFlight Expo. So thank you for joining us here. And if you have more questions, perhaps some of those folks here on the stage could stay. Otherwise, we'll keep you updated. Thank you.